They are in the Orient, the beginning of biblical faith. And there's no uncertainty as to the relationship. You will know that David is your son, and he will know that you are his father. He's fulfilled in the scripture, the second Psalm. I will tell of the decree of the Lord. He said unto me, thou art my son. Today I have begun. You will never know that God gave himself to you in any other way than the one way when his son calls you father. When he calls you father, you will know who you are. And then you can judge for the rest of eternity, and no one which is convinced until they have this experience concerning you. My character is only one God. That body is the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one spirit. There's only one hope. Only one Lord. Only one faith. Only one baptism. Only one God. Who is the Father of us all. Who is through all, above all, and in all. And this is how you will know. The man who dares to claim this, he is what he claims. Now let me give you the experience of 2 minutes from LA. I have what I've experienced. I'm writing that I have. I tell it to others, not convincingly, because it seems, like I told you earlier, it seems blasphemous. For you and I are ready to believe that a man 2,000 years ago was the Christ and only the Christ, and no one has seen Christ. In spite of scripture that tells us, do you not realize that Jesus Christ is in you? God, if you're perfectly honest with yourself, you would say, no, I don't know the Lord. But read it in the 13th chapter of 2 Corinthians. Do you not realize that Jesus Christ is in you? And he who is united to the Lord is one spirit with the Lord. And that he shall change our lowly bodies to be of one form with his glorious body. Now here are the 2 experiences. A lady finds herself in a large interior. The entire throat is blessed. They are marble bones, and it's very softly furnished. There's but one chair, and she finds herself seated in it, looking through the breast. He sees a carriage, self-propelled, coming to him. A door opens automatically, and out steps from this door the speaker, dressed in normal clothes, wearing an Inverness cape. I came into the place where she was, I ignored her. I showed no recognition of her, but began to speak on power, infinite power. And she knows, she said, well, this is Neville. But it is God. It is Neville, and it is God. And she kept on repeating this. Then I came to the end, I still did not recognize her. I paid no attention to her, just speaking, proclaiming power. Then she said, as though by appointment, the carriage came into view once more. I turned and re-entered this carriage and that, holding back. It was sheer power. When I was sent to do the work I am doing, it was power to command. I was first embraced by infinite love. And I fused with it while I'm one with love and expanded. The risen Lord, I was standing before a being who was infinite power. Now you might think, it's another being. No, God plays all the parts. God is a protean being. Like Proteus, the legendary sea god, in the service of Neptune. He could assume any shape, any form, any body, in the service of the one who sent him. So infinite power is the same And we are told in Scripture that Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. So when we see me speaking only of power, an infinite power, she knew who I was. I returned from God to the beginning, from now to the end of time. I could not persuade her. She would have to have it shown to her by the only means that was showing her, and that is God. For God speaks to man through the medium of dream, but he reveals himself through the medium of vision, as told us in the first chapter of the book of Numbers. But had she not the vision herself, I could go from now to time, and I could not read the Savior. Of the truth of what I'm talking about. Then, another way, I came upon a sea. There was an enormous sea, and every type of person was present, all different nationalities. And strangely enough, they heard you in the town wherein they were born. And you were simply standing, not on the water, you were standing on the beach, but to your back was an infinite body of water, a huge lake, but you saw no shoreline. And there you were clothed in a white robe, and you were speaking to the entire crowd. I knew you were heaven, and yet at the same time, I knew you were Jesus. And there was no uncertainty in my mind. I knew this devil, and I also know that it is Jesus. Now that seems insane. If I know from experience, everyone in this world is the Lord Jesus Christ. There's only one Lord. You do not lose your identity. You remain what you are. You're John, you're Mary, you're Peter. You remain the individualized being that you are, and yet you are Jesus. Yet you are God. And everyone is destined to move toward the fulfillment of that which was in the beginning eternity, to be all God. There's no room in eternity for two gods. No room in eternity for another. But you and I separated from God. God, in the sense only of losing him as to who you became. That's the separation. At this very moment, I cannot remember who I am. I haven't gone any place, but I certainly have separated from the being that I knew myself to be. So when I say that we are separated from God, I mean it in that sense. So separation from God at once is a tragedy and in a triumph. It's a fall, and yet it is the beginning of a new creation. And this separation, which is now incarnation, and complete incarnation is essential to individual. A complete incarnation, which now entails complete forgetfulness of the incarnation. But I thank that cup of forgetfulness. And he says, shall I not drink the cup? It's the Father has given me. The vision of the cup is forgetting who I am. And believing that I am a little being of flesh and blood. Everyone came out from the Father. He said, I came out from the Father. And I came into the world. Again, I'm leaving the world. And I'm going to the Father. So coming out of the Father is simply to forget the being that I am. And believing myself to be this fragmented being seen billions of us, and I am now at war with my fragmented self. Not knowing that everyone I meet is my very self pushed out, but is no other. Until this experience happens in man, when it happens in man, he doesn't go and shout to the housetop, he does it to an intimate circle. And in that small circle, still only a very few will ever really know. Those who have the experience, meeting him in an entirely different world. For this drama is not secular. This drama of Scripture is a supernatural drama. There is no secular history in Scripture. The whole thing unfolds within the depths of the soul of man. And everyone is destined to have this experience. When the question is asked, who am I? You can ask it of anyone, say like a Peter. But Peter had a revelation not from a book, not from reason. He didn't sit down to rationalize the scripture. It was unveiled from within. When the Lord says, flesh and blood, but not a way that you saw, the truth of what you now declare, I accept your confession. But now then let me reinterpret this concept that man holds concerning Messiah. It's a false concept. The expression that comes from another, and he never comes from another, he comes from you. And it comes so suddenly that no one is prepared for it. It comes out of the blue, as though told in Scripture, just like the thief of the night. When he comes, no one is ready. And in my own case, these four major things in my life were certainly not expected. First, I'm not in the and that was the verse for us. When we speak, when you're told in Scripture, unless you are born from above, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. There is a must, but I have no concept, none whatsoever, that that word was literally true. I thought that was going to be a figure of speech. That I, a big man, grown man, the father of children, and that I must be born again. But I asked that Nicodemus, how is this possible? How can I, a man, a mature man, once more enter my mother's womb and be born? Praying at the time that I was reborn, like in the city, my mother was gone from this earth. How could it be? I didn't realize. In that day, which was 1959. But that drama was literally true. Until, within me, the whole thing began to unfold. And my whole being became the most intense vibration. And I found myself weak. Waking from a long, long sleep. And where I wake, I awoke within my skull. My skull was a tomb, and it sealed. And then, I came out of it like a child coming out of the womb of a woman. And then the entire drama of Scripture confronts me. Clear to me, as known as the third chapter of the book of John. When he tells Nicodemus, you must be born again. And that word, translated again, is the Greek word halogen, which means from above, that is from God. Literally from above. Not from the womb of woman below, but from the womb of God above, which is the skull of man. That's where the real man began to dream this strange, peculiar dream of man. And that's where man will awaken. And out of that dream, man will come. It awakes, and awakening is the resurrection. You wake from the long, long sleep. It was so profound, it seemed like the sleep of death. For you are a Jew, and you know it's a Jew, yet you know it was God. And how did you come? And then the wind, the peculiar, unearthly wind, and you feel it, you hear it. And your attention is diverted from that body out of which you just emerged. You're only diverted from that a second, but when you're pressed, the body is gone. You fulfill the scripture, where have they taken your body? The body is gone. But in its place, you'll find three names. In my case, you might see on the road. And then it was where the body formerly, just a few seconds ago, lay. They are two disturbed by the wind. And one who is not gone from this world, he wrote. And so he knows what he thought was the cause of the disturbance over left hand. He may not know that a couple of steps when something attracted his attention on the floor. Looking up, he said, why is Neville's baby? And other brothers said, how can Neville have a baby? With this, he doesn't argue the point. He lists the evidence. He lists a little child wrapped in swaddling clothes and puts it on the baby. And then I lift the little angel. And that was in daring term, I said, how is my sweetheart? The child had the most heavenly smile, and it broke into the smile of the whole scene below. And that was the first of the major acts. Then came the mother, fell on three mighty acts to complete the four signs of man. By now, from my own personal experience, I'm not realizing what is in store for every child of the world. It does mean that if you know that you know beyond the veil, did not have this experience. They're not dead. Nothing dies in darkness. They are restored to life. Infinitely restored, and I do know my experience. No reincarnation, they're restored. And they're young. And new. same body, in the world of the relative gas bodies, and unaccountably new, my dear, this man, out of someone's dark age and mansion, withered and shrunken, in pain. And when you see them, within a matter of moments, they are only 20 years old. They're not a baby. They are young. Unaccountably new. Your limb is missing if they have a limb missing, if it's missing. If they have hair missing, teeth missing, legs missing, if you stop missing. If they're blind, they're not blind. The body is restored, but not resurrected. Resurrection is a completely from restoration. All bodies are restored. It's a miracle. And the being is still continuing in a world of dust like this. Devils who are resurrected do not enter that world. They are in heaven. They are one with the body of the risen Christ, without loss of identity. And everyone who is restored or are restored will continue in a world just like this. With the same problems, they're very few, and they're just afraid of dying there as they are there, and they're dying there to be restored. And this restoration goes on until they awake in the tomb of their own self. When they will have the vertical life. So who am I? The very one spoken of in Scripture. You ask that question, who am I? And the answer is, I am the Lord Jesus Christ. But you don't know it really until you experience it. I promise you, you will experience it. Not one can fail for a single reason. God, and God alone, who is playing the part. He's playing all the part. So when David comes into your world, there's no other way that you will ever know that you really are the Lord Jesus Christ. So listen to the words carefully. No one asked him the question. The Sadducees were called the signers of his death. They did not believe in the resurrection. So they say to him, to trip him up, Master, Moses said that in the resurrection, a man's wife, at first point, makes a vision. That Moses said, if a man is married and he died, leaving no offspring, and he has brothers, then the son should marry the widow to raise up offspring for his brother. Well, there were seven of them. The first one married and died leaving no offspring, the second took him. He died leaving no offspring, the third took him. Finally, all married. All died leaving no offspring, and then she died. Now tell us, whose wife is she in the resurrection? And the answer, you do not know Scripture. For in the resurrection, they neither married nor are they newly married. Those who are accounted worthy to attain the perfect, they neither marry nor are they given in marriage. For they are sons of the resurrection. They are sons of God. And the Son of God is one with God. For I, my Father, are one. But those who have not attained to that age, they continue marrying and they are given in marriage. Here is an entire concept of what is sought concerning what is your future. Your real future is Jesus Christ. There is no other body. There is no other spirit. One being, trimane. See how it was told us in the Old Testament. It's the 82nd Psalm. And God has taken his place in the divine council. In the midst of the gods, he holds judgment. And I say of gods, all sons of the Most High, nevertheless, you will die like me, and go as one man for these reasons. It is said by scholars, it's the most difficult passage in the entire Bible to understand. That if one died, the idea of burial is no longer understood by the scholars of the world, because it can only be known through vision. One man, according to the words, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Therefore, who fell? The one man. He's not for a purpose. Nothing wrong. Not a thing was wrong in this world. heavenly laws of passion that you are. These are all laws of the animal world. Filled to overflow with passion. And then I tell you, under threat of death, you must not entertain one consistent thought. I already convict you, or I convicted you of death and sent you to death. For strength of talents, restraint is not enough. A man who lusts after the woman has already committed an act in his heart. So put me in an animal body filled with passion and tell me that I must not have a concupiscent thought. If convicted, if you tell me the result of my concupiscence is death, or may I must die. So nonetheless, I say your name, and you will have died like me. You will fall as one man, O ye Christians. So the one man is scattered. Like a rock being broken in strike nation. Everyone now has begun to tell you the same one being, one rock. But glorified by reason of the experience. But now scripture tells us, I did you wrong in the fall. Our priests of the world tell us that he did wrong. But then listen to these words. If disobedience broke me out from the fall and caused me to lose the identity of my own being, which is Jesus Christ. I believe myself to be a man. In one of these words in the scripture, in the 11th chapter of the book of Romans, God has consigned all men to disobedience, that he may have mercy upon all. So if disobedience drove me out, the cause of my disobedience was the one who plowed me in the snow on the skin. For he put me at animal body, and then threatened me with death if I obeyed a concupiscent thought. How could I help it? What man in this world, if he has any red blood, he can tell me he will have helped him. Even if you enter the extreme and you emasculate yourself, you still will entertain the thought. If you are ignorant, the thought is still there. While the enemy is thrown down into generation, you cannot help it. When the curtain of your body is torn in two from top to bottom, and then the enemies are reversed into regeneration, you can take all the world and expose them in the new before you, and there is no desire. You could make a king of the cubicle thought. But until that moment, when you are turned down into generation, then you are condemned to death. By reason of the fact, he who shall tell me, I must not eat of this, is the one who said to me, he made me disobedient. For he confined all men, consigned all men to disobedience, that he may have mercy upon all. So in the end, all be heard, all forgiven, and everything is there. Man, when he's done, can't believe that. He wants to punish, he wants to hurt. But you then have never stood in the presence of evil time. You cannot be in the presence of the risen Christ and feel any emotion but love. Impossible to feel anything but love and even be right in the place of the risen Christ. He asks a very simple question. What is the greatest thing in the world? And automatically, as though you are divinely prompted, you answer. Faith, hope, and love. These three. But the greatest of these is love. At that moment he praises you. And you fuse, and you become one with the risen Lord. And he who is united with the Lord becomes one spirit with him. One with him in the resurrection. So the crucifixion is over all. The resurrection is taking place one after one after one. And not one will fail. So all at once been crucified and with Christ. Everyone, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. So his crucifixion was our crucifixion. Now, the resurrection has started. And one after the other is being awakened within the tomb of their own skull. And the drama unfolds within them and out their God. But in the end, it should only be the Lord Jesus Christ. So when you are told in scripture, they saw the Lord sacrifice. They saw the prophet son of God, Moses and Elijah, and there is Jesus transfigured before. When your eyes were opened, it was Jesus of each man in the body of Jesus. Only as one body. And yet you will not lose your identity, but those who have the vision will see you, know you, and so know that you are Jesus. They will know you and so know that you are God and the power of God. And Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. So this treasure is not something that man depends on. Treasure that cannot carry that you are Jesus Christ. I will stand there and you will still be awesome in the book, but you will still be unpersuaded. You will go and say, you'll have many done in saying or it's a sheer blasphemy, or it's in conflict with what the church is taught. But I am not centering. I am not theorizing. I speak from experience. I tell you what I know from my own personal experience. I didn't read in the book. I was not taught it by man. It simply came by the revelation of Jesus Christ. In the same manner that you read it in the very first chapter of the book of Galatians, Paul saying, I did not receive it from man. Neither was I taught, but it came through a revelation of Jesus Christ. And he tells you there is no other gospel. And he made this claim that the sin in Scripture before the four gospels were written. In fact, it was not only written before the four, but it was already an established school of thought. It's all solid down by the study of Scripture. The earliest book in the New Testament is Paul's letter to the Galatians. And no one dates it later than 52 AD. And yet our Gospels go anyway from 70 AD up to 95 AD. So a generation after Paul's letter appeared, instructing the Galatians, and then came his Thessalonians, and then came his Corinthians, and these all we see the Gospels. So I know that the story of Jesus Christ is the story of every child born of woman. That we all come together and all will rise in our own true time. He calls us one by one by one. And meanwhile, he tries us in the furnace of affliction, as we are told in Isaiah. I try you in the furnace of affliction. For my own sake I do. For my own sake I do. For how should my glory be given to another? I will not give my glory to another. You have to become him to receive his glory. The day will come to take off these garments of flesh and blood and put on the garment of glory, which is yours. You took it off for the spirits, and you came out of heaven to have this spirits. You had it and you'll return glorified. And that's how we inwardly expand. There is no limit to transmutation. Your expansion. There is only a limit to contraction. And man is a limit to contraction. Man is the limit of a path. But the day will come to a great share. And then you will add to the glory of the body of God. For your glory adds to that glory. And it all expands beyond the other. Now this may appear a little different. What you had last year. Or even in previous years. But this is based upon the experiences of the last year and 10 months. Not my own personal experiences, but they go back to 1959. But I didn't get confirmation from those in the office. Now, a lady will have experience in this manner. She will call the pattern, not of Abraham, she will call the pattern of Sarah. And Sarah was too old to have a child. Or the son of Sarah, it had ceased to be with her after the manner of women. In other words, she would be incapable of conceiving a child and carrying it to fruition, as you read in the book of Genesis. So a lady has it in this now. I can give you a dozen from my audience today. You'll get one. She has two brothers. She hasn't seen these brothers in 40 years. She has a landlord whom she looked upon as a younger brother. She was away from home one night, I think she rarely does, and then she leaves the city. But she was in the city, and someone was distressed and asked her to please keep your life. But she said, I've got to go home, first of all, and tell my neighbors where I am, because they didn't pay the money, they're elderly ladies. You call that a and was carried on in a strange person in a strange atmosphere. And here I am, in the wee hours of the morning, I feel this peculiar breeze and vibration in my ear. It increases in intensity, but it reaches the apex of intensity suddenly. Here comes my two brothers that I haven't seen in over 40 years, and my landlord. My oldest brother said, but she is too old to have a baby. No, they agree, but he still picks up the infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and puts it in his sister's arms. Now, this lady is 77 years old, a retired school teacher of L.A. It comes in her case as it comes to Sarah, too old to have a child. But this is not a physical child. This is a supernatural experience. So he heard the word, she heard the word, but she is too old to have a child. Then angel was raised on the floor and put into her head. After that, she found herself in the canyon where she lives. And like my experience, she's the canyon, the right side of the canyon. And here comes this blonde, blue-eyed man. And she said, I did not have to ask you whose son are you, my man. I knew he was my son, and I knew he was made of biblical faith. She said, every experience of the devil, that takes 9 months and 2 years after the third mighty one. She would have it because she had the first three. And so, a man differs in this birth of a woman. She takes the pattern of Sarah, and he takes the pattern of Abraham. But the identical picture has related these scriptures. So you dwell upon it tonight, even though you cannot completely accept it, you dwell upon it. Who am I? If you tell it the truth, you never know what he's talking about. As you really have these experiences, ask that. And see if you cannot get from within yourself an answer to the truth of what I'm talking about. I tell you, the answer will come. In some strange way, God will answer you, for God is not being a follower. God is within you. He is never so far off as even to be near, for nearness implies separation. God cannot even be near. Why? Because his name is to me. What's his name? I am. When you find anything that he would be, but you can't say I am his name, it's the core, it's the root, it's the very center of me. My name is there, my head is there, my brains are there. But I can say I am and entertain the word name. And I am is the name of God forever. If I am is his name forever, well then he cannot be far off. In fact, he cannot be even so far off as to be near. For nearness implies separation. That's who you really are. And that name, which is I am, that's God. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. When he asks, who do you say? I am. In King, you are. He could have said, you are the power of God. What the word Christ defined in Corinthians as the power of God and the wisdom of God. One day, you will have experience. And you will see someone who has made the claim without boasting. And you will come upon a scene. And the scene will unveil itself before you. And you will know her claim or his claim is a true claim. Or you'll know you can be Jesus, or know how to be Jesus, and you still will not seek and it's not the thing you know. No loss of identity, and yet Jesus. And you come back to your waiting state here, and there is no uncertainty in your mind as to what experience, and who is God within you. God unveils himself in you. Now let us. More I get from myself, with the key to be made, Father, this system. I hope so. And I want to train you all. But I do hope you heard it. That more I can gather if they get this little set fixed, and they promise that they will. Now, are there any questions?
Yeah.
told us in Ephesians. Don't get it from the oneness of God. The foundation of the whole faith begins with that Shema, or the confession of the people. Hear, O Israel, Lord our God, the Lord is one. You can't get away from that. When Jesus asked the name, the greatest of all the commandments, he did not mention what we call the Ten. He quoted this commandment. Hear, O Israel, Lord our God, the Lord is one. It's a compound unit, one made up of many. That's what the word means. The word Elohim is a plural word. And it's not, but yet, being plural, it's made up of many. There are billions of us, but we're all part of that one body. That one body fell, that one body should rise, getting with it all, but it is all in good time, into the new living temple. So I don't care what folks come out. Many of us think because something is true, it is true. But nothing of you are false to that. Morning paper, that comes out. That's pretty true. Nothing of violence. I'm publicity. I have a scheme I want to put over, and so I get behind with my translations. And they write all the lies in the world that the paper brings it. And you read it. And because of the printing of the paper, but it must be true, but nothing could be further from the truth. But because the magic creates the other, it will prove itself in performance. And no other. There's nothing but God. You do not. At that day, not resurrection, you do not find yourself restored to life. You're one with the body of God. It'll come to everyone. Only one part of God will be lost, and that is impossible. He said, it is not your Father's will that one be lost.
I can't take it off until I need. Oh,
one that resurrects. He's the resurrecting one. Can you be divided by air?
No, but I
mean, well, that's you now. That's because you can hear my air, you say I am, and it can't be divided. Well, that's you would like to speak to this God. Before this priest, you can claim I am he. You're telling me you do not claim I am he who died in your sins. You're passing the buck. There's some other person who do not do it. That's it. You don't resurrect right now. That comes with you alone. But you're emphasizing the power of God right now. All the power of God is your own wonderful human identity. That's God. So when you say, I am me, by the way, that's the power of God. And you will be me. When you say, I am unwanted, that's the power of God, and you will be unwanted. But if in the space of all things you say, I am nothing, I am contributing to the world's good, in spite of the absence of all evidence to the contrary, you will contribute. And you want. For you use the power of God. Right now, you do not use the power of God. There is only God's power. But you can steal the devil. What devil? Listen to the word of the scripture. You run. I kill. And I make alive. I move. And I heal. And I raise my hand to heaven and cry, I make well. There is no God beside me. The same one that kills is the one that makes alive. The one that worships is the one that curses. Because man is the uncle of God. And he has to offer it. God became man that man may become God. But I am is not future. I am is present. You didn't say I love God. I am the Lord. It's not past and future. I am. So give him the power now. Any other verses, please? It's a natural question of my head and my ear. This is not a serious dream. This is a plan. This is not something that is a result of some emergency thinking on the part of God. This was planned in the beginning of God. He chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Why? To expand. If God was finished, forever and ever, it would not expand, then he would find out God. He has to reach contraction and the limit of contraction to break. He has to jump to prove that he really is. And so, this is a constant, wonderful challenge forever. This is an end of joy when we all awake. And the whole thing seems to be the most striking thing in the beginning. But we had faith, like Abraham, faith in God, that he could die and still love God. And so the power that comes as an increase of power, an increase of wisdom, an increase of human love. Not that anyone believes God is a finished product. Truth is an ever increasing illumination. Why did the Kennedys have to suffer? My dear, I can say the boys suffer. The family will left behind if you read it. We do not even recognize our own hearts. No one knows the thoughts of a man but the spirit of man who dwells in him. Likewise, no man knows the thoughts of God but the spirit of God who dwells in him. Who knows what thoughts these boys entertain? The three of them were killed by the mere son of the sister. Joseph was killed in the war. His sister was killed, her husband was killed, and the least boy was assassinated. Who knows what thoughts they entertained? To be dramatic, I do not know. In other words, every done when the first one was assassinated, to identify his name with Lincoln. The same thing, not Lincoln, but he was assassinated too. But they tried to make it a limitless picture, to study for the union, and they've done it. So that if you want power, not power, but I mean, glory on earth, they certainly have. They have it if you want on earth. But all the things in earth will vanish and need not a trace to that. Everything here is going to pass away as though it never were. And all the women. Now here, obviously, you cannot violate Scripture. Scripture must be fulfilled immediately. David is described in the 16th chapter of 1 Samuel as a young man. He's described as right. Right. And beautiful eyes, implying blue, blue, wonderful eyes, and a ruddy complexion. In my audience, the blackest man I have ever seen, and I was born among black people in Barbados. And we have a blue man in Barbados. But Benny is the blackest man I have ever seen. Benny is the father of Benny, and he knows it. Benny is having strength in the burden of us. And what of the child? A little baby. A little rosy cheek. That's very sad. It would be impossible for Benny to marry the most blonde woman in this world and produce that child. Until he's so black. You'll never see anyone as black as Benny. Benny who? Benny strong stomach up. He's had the breath come out. And that child is placed in his own arms is a little blonde, blue-eyed, rosy cheek child. It's the Christ child. The Christ child is the child. And David is a God. David. He has objectified using him as example. To prove that we are not black or we are not all things or white. You're spirit. But God is approaching me. And the same God that plays the part of heaven plays the part of David. For David said, I am, that's God. And I said, I am, that's God. Look at each other, and I can't see how we've come out of the same mirrors. Have we not come out? We are the mirror. We are the mirror. My dear, I'm not in the mirror. But God gives man complete freedom of choice. Listen to these words. I said before you this day, night and day, blessings and curses, good and evil, choose life. It's entirely up to man. If I were not free in my choice, I'm a god. If I had to be good, I'm not good. But give me choice, and let me hear your face. Man will not recognize his own law. It couldn't happen without a cause, and the cause is in the imagination of man. Imagination creates everything. That's how it happens. So if I want to make a fortune, and I have the means, and that makes me serve others. But what's happening now? God alone, the great 200 million people, really want laws to protect the neighborhood. But you know, or I can register my car. Why can't I register now? They don't say I can't have the car. They say you'll have the car because we have a car. But there must be a license for it. And a renewal year after year. So if they come into my house and I can't produce that license, I'm going to throw it out. Well, then it's going to touch it. Was it stolen? Did I sell it? Did I give it away? I must keep track of that thing that I bought. I have a license. I'm getting out of this horrible thing you have to know, one of the three, Martin Luther King and the two Kennedys, and the demand of the entire nation to have a license. Other countries have it. We still say no. What a fantastic law. You get these people who are the lawmakers. Wrong. If we insist on doing it, we'll do it. You can't stop a man from a man. Put me in jail and throw away the key. You can't stop a man. And who knows who is threatening your life best? It could be some woman right in a jail, even if she is injured, that she is not entitled to that treatment. And she is carrying on in her mind's eye the most dramatic scenes. And they are love scenes. And these are all seeds of being planted. and when the seeds come up for every seed, we don't even recognize our promise. But I think the time is just for that. I'll take one more. He is the Word. The written Word must be matched by the living Word. Scripture must be fulfilled in me. So I come as the living Word. If I'm the living Word, then what? Text 13 was parallel to what God wrote through His promise. There is the written Word. Heaven is in the family union of humanity with God. Yeah, because that one brother, wherever the Lord Jesus from among us, that heaven is common. So wherever that body is, there is no thunder. That angel created power and wisdom and love. So union with that body is heaven. So heaven is really the final union of humanity with God. And there is only God. There is nothing but God. So all things will pass away, but God cannot pass away. And He redeems us one by one by one, even in His own body. Whose body is that? The Lord Jesus Christ. So when many say, well, I'm a very wise person, I have PhDs, I have all these degrees for himself, and I don't believe one word who says, but they are. Then they will say, I'm religious. You know what the Bible calls religious? He could be the wisest thing among men, but we the 53rd Psalm. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. Only the fool. So what he calls a fool is in the eyes of God. Why is compared to what he is in the eyes of God? He has to go through so many things to burn off the nonsense that he acquired in the world of men. And all these are punishments he would be owed. The loss of a child at the furnace. A broken faith at the furnace. All these emotional conflicts in the furnaces. The upper earth is where you walk through actual fire. These are the fires, and they mingle and burn. And so all these are the fires of earth that I put through. And in the aim is infinite mercy redeemed. I didn't acquire it. Let no one brag, let no one boast. No one can buy a fiery merit.